everyone. We're going to reconvene. Councillor Clare. Councillor Clare. Can you grab Clare? Thank you. We can't start without the full composition here. So we are now going to be starting the Committee of the Whole meeting of June 6, 2023. I'm calling our meeting to order at 8:06 p.m. Are there any disclosures of pecuniary interest? Seeing none, I am so excited about our, well, both of our delegations, but in particular, our one delegation today. I'm going to put my bias right out there. I want to welcome very warmly the future of Port Hope, Oliver Harwood and Abigail Spencer, to the podium. You have 10 minutes to speak, and please press the purple button to ensure the microphone is on, and I'm sure somebody will help you if you can't find it. Oliver and Abigail are grade 5-6 Beatrice Strong public school students, and they're going to be talking to us about the ban of single-use plastics in the municipality of Port Hope.
All right, hello.
Hi.
Hello. Okay. So thank you for taking me here today for this meeting. Today, as you can see right there, we are talking about single-use plastics, and yeah, okay. Before we begin, we'd like to introduce ourselves. I'm Oliver Harwood. I'm a grade 6 student at Beecher Strong Public School, and I'm honored and grateful to be here speaking in front of all of you guys today.
And then again, I am Abigail Spencer, and I'm also a grade 6 student here, also from Beatrice, here speaking and sharing with you all today about single-use plastics and its effects on the environment in our own town.
What are single-use plastics? Single-use plastics are a type of plastics that are only used once and only for a short period of time during consumption or anything, like you can have them during conversations while you drive, anything like that. And they're always thrown most of the places like ditches, lakes, sea, they're thrown in the sea sometimes, lawns, and they're all scattered around our houses. And right now at this point, recycling plastic is right now the most effective means of avoiding this waste all around the world. So carrying like reusable bags, bottles is one great way to avoid single-use plastics in our oceans. In our day-to-day lives, this will help reduce pollution and demand for plastic production that's contributing to global climate change.
Here we have some examples. Some examples could be food containers, cutlery, coffee cups, straws, plastic water bottles, plastic bags, and wrappers, and some more that you can see on the screen. So, our class partnered with Circle Comedy Ambassadors Program and did a local garbage cleanup around our school, during which we found many single-use plastic items. On top of the cleanup, we have been learning and conducting our own research on this issue.
So here's some little facts. Humans use about 1.2 million plastic bottles per minute in total. Approximately 90% of plastic is not recycled as of March 2022. There are more than 5.5 0.25 trillion macro pieces of plastic in our oceans as we speak.
Before we move on, I would also like to add that during the cleanup, we sorted and counted all the plastic items, and we noticed many items were mostly thrown into our natural areas, including forests, creeks, and ditches. We have a video for you, so yeah.
Oh.
We regularly have technical problems. So I'm sure we'll figure it out. Just think of it as a commercial pause.
Welcome to a special video about single-use plastics. Today, we're going to explore the dark side of these seemingly harmless materials that have become an everyday part of our lives. Join me as we uncover the devastating impact single-use plastics have on our environment and the beautiful creatures we share this planet with. First, let's understand what single-use plastics are. They are products designed to be used only once before they are thrown away or recycled. Think of items like plastic straws, water bottles, cutlery, and grocery bags. Although they seem convenient, they come with a heavy environmental cost. The production of single-use plastics begins with the extraction of fossil fuels, such as oil and natural gas. These raw materials are then processed to create various types of plastic resins. The resins are molded into the plastic products we use daily, consuming a considerable amount of energy and generating pollution in the process. The production of single-use plastics is energy intensive, releasing large amounts of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. These emissions contribute to climate change, further exacerbating the problem. Disposing of single-use plastics is no easy feat. Many plastics end up in landfills where they can leach harmful chemicals into the ground. Others are incinerated, releasing toxic pollutants into the air. A significant amount of plastic waste also finds its way into our oceans, threatening marine life and ecosystems. Unlike organic materials, plastics do not biodegrade quickly. Some types of plastic can take hundreds of years to break down, persisting in the environment and causing harm to wildlife and ecosystems for generations. Animals can become entangled in plastic waste or mistake it for food, leading to injury or death. Microplastics, tiny plastic particles, have also been found in the food chain, posing potential risks to human health. The environmental impact of single-use plastics is undeniable. It's time for us to reconsider our reliance on these products and find sustainable alternatives. By reducing our plastic consumption and supporting eco-friendly initiatives, we can help protect our planet for future generations. Let's make a change together. Start by sharing this video and raising awareness about the harm of single-use plastics. Remember, every little step counts. Worksheets relating to this short video can be downloaded by creating a free
So here we have a little, whatever you want to call it, just basically, oh, just gonna put you on the spot here, give you a quick quiz on how long some of these single-use plastics will be around for.
And we can disclose that when we did a test run on this, that many of the council members had no clue as to the answers, so it was very educational. Does anybody want to take a guess on plastic bottles?
I'll take this one because they said it earlier, hundreds of years.
Who wants to take a plastic bag? Councillor Adam?
Well, based off the plastic bottle, I'm going to say 375 years.
Councillor Mink, cigarette filter?
Now, this is the filter. 150 years.
Actually, I think somebody in the audience had an answer for styrofoam. Coffee cup. How about our CAO take a stab at that one?
Sure. I would say 75 years.
Plastic straw, our deputy clerk.
Oh, no, I don't actually. I would say 300 years.
That was a good guess. Plastic cutlery, Councillor Collins.
Add the years together, let's go with 100.
So how we can help, we believe there is some serious action that needs to take place in order to reduce plastic waste and plastic pollution in Port Hope. Things like purchasing reusable water bottles, straws can go a long way, packing reusable grocery bags when you go grocery shopping, or buying items in bulk and storing leftovers in containers instead of plastic. We are here today to ask for your help. Port Hope needs your help in taking a stand to ban single-use plastics, or at least most single-use plastics that are found all over the place.
So well done and so informative. Thank you so much for coming and speaking with us this evening. And now I'm going to turn it over and see if any of the council members have any questions for you. Councillor Collins.
Again, thank you very much for that very educational presentation. And thank you very much for your patience for sitting through the first session. Very, very beautiful to see. Got a question for you. If you had to make a decision and you were sitting up here and you asked the community to ban all single plastics, but the majority said, no, we don't want to yet, would you still pass it?
Myself personally, I would say yes, because the community may think it's bad, but the earth thinks it's worse.
Councillor Adam.
Thank you, so through the chair. I can't thank you enough for coming out and doing this presentation. Absolutely fantastic, and it takes a lot of guts to get up in front of us and all these people here to make that presentation. I would like to make a promise to you that I will do my best in the future to change my habits to use less plastic. And I'm going to come over and shake your hand if you don't mind.
Any other, yes, we've got a few more questions. Councillor Mink.
Thank you. And thank you for this presentation. And thank you for waiting so long for that council meeting. They usually don't last that long. So you're troopers. So congratulations. I don't know if I read that Beatrice Strong within your school, something is happening with single-use plastics. Is that true? Can you tell me if anything?
I think so. I'm not 100% sure, but we do have this thing going on in our school where every month we have some people, and our janitor actually organized it. So we have some people, because a lot of kids are just throwing out instead of throwing things in the recycling, they're throwing it in the garbage or leaving it all over the classroom. So we have a few kids every month who signed up for this recycling team kind of thing, and they go around the school, like inside, and take all the garbage cans and all the recycling things. And then they actually sort through it all for a little bit of the day. So they get to skip class soon, which is a win-win.
Councillor Clare.
Thank you, and well done. For anyone who reads the Mayor's Corner, you'll know that Oliver and Abby are here as representatives this evening of their class, but this was actually a full class project. But given the timing of our meetings, it wasn't feasible for all members of the class to attend this meeting. So we had a special pre-meeting, a little field trip with the class, where the whole class came down to town hall, and the mayor and Councillor Less and I had an opportunity to meet with that class. So we had a little sneak peek of their delegation. And I had an opportunity since then to check in with Councillor Less, and we agreed that we would like to take you up on your request to take some action on single-use plastics in our community. And to that end, I would like to introduce a motion this evening for consideration by my council colleagues. I had some time to prepare. So the motion is, whereas single-use plastics are a contributor to carbon emissions, to pollution, and to litter in our community, as outlined by the delegation from Beatrice Strong Public School, and whereas the Municipality of Port Hope has declared a climate emergency, and whereas the Municipality of Port Hope is undertaking the development of a community climate action plan with leadership from our Environmental Advisory Committee, now be it resolved that the Environmental Advisory Committee be directed to report back to Council with recommendations for a single-use plastics bylaw for inclusion in our community climate action plan. And your second.
And I will second it. And I knew the answers to all your questions.
And to the clerk, do we need to do a vote on this, or are we just needing a mover and a seconder on this?
Sounds like we have a motion that's germane to tonight's presentation. We have a mover and seconder. So whenever you're ready, Madam Mayor, you can call a vote.
Okay. This is the future of Port Hope. Let's give them another round of applause. And now I will take a vote. All in favor? Thank you. It's passed. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
That was wonderful.
Okay, moving on to the second delegation of this evening, 3.2, Zoltan Zadvorsky regarding zoning bylaw 2020-10 and registered compiled plan 173. I request that the presenter approach the podium and turn on the purple button, and you have 10 minutes to present, please.
Good evening, your worship and council. I will only take 5 minutes. I know everybody is tired. It's been a long night. We have been residents of Port Hope for 10 years. During this time, we found that our community is getting better, and we hope this trend is going to continue. We love Port Hope, and we plan to live here for a long time. I should have made this presentation at the March 1st meeting, but I was not aware of the issue then. However, I'm grateful that you are giving me a chance now to present my comments. This presentation is to add some important facts that were missing from Mr. McDonald's Meridian Planning Consultants report dated March 1st, 2023. Since they were inaccuracies in that report, I feel this addition is extremely pertinent and crucial for the council to be able to make an informed decision. The report stated that all properties in that area are too small and unsuitable for development. However, there are a number of properties in Plan 173 south of the railway that are larger than 1 acre. Including mine, which happened to be 7 acres and the largest in that plan. All of these large properties are located in prime location, either by Lakeshore Road or East Town Line Roads, or by the lake itself, standing quite apart from the majority of the small landlocked parcels. I do agree with Mr. McDonald that many of the fragmented small properties are very poorly located, either on the swampy ravines or on the side slopes. These are extremely difficult to access and probably ill-suited for development. However, with sufficient funds and land engineering, anything is possible. Even with the fact that such parcels have difficulty to get fresh water or build proper waste systems. I purchased my property after visiting and studying the site. Perhaps others failed to do that. These lots were sold during the previous council's tenure, for which the municipality earned substantial income. Furthermore, for years, the owners have paid regular taxes for which they received virtually no services. This bylaw proposal will further restrict the owner's lawful enjoyment of their land. I bought my land to have a private wooded lakeside nature sanctuary. However, these prime lakeshore parcels are also investment properties, having easy access to water and plenty of surface area to accommodate sophisticated septic systems. Therefore, I cannot see any reason to restrict the use of these properties just because these are also in registered plan number 173. Many years ago, I made a presentation to the previous council suggesting to create a recreational walk park to utilize the unsold lots. Since then, Port Hope has wasted all the unsold plots. As a result, an estimated half of the total 173 plan area is already being owned by the municipality. My suggestion is to facilitate a solution that will benefit all the owners and the community of Port Hope. As far as the few small, isolated, unusable parcels are concerned, since they have no economic viability to be developed or even used as recreational lots, owners should be offered a buyback opportunity. In conclusion, I offer to any member of the council a walkabout in that particular area, which I know quite well. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Mr. Zadvorsky. And now I'm going to open it up to the council for any questions. Yes, Councillor Less.
Thank you for your presentation. And I think some of your thoughts deserve our further thinking. Of course, that would be a monetary obligation on the part of the municipality. So we'd have to think about what we are doing, but it's never been brought forward in that format before. So I thank you, and I'm sure that we will discuss further.
I'm also aware that there have been other presentations, but I couldn't come at that time because I didn't know this happened. And I know they have other takes on it, and the council will have, I'm sure, lots of opportunity to think it over and consider all the aspects of the issue. And thanks again. Anybody else would like to? The offer is there. If anybody wants to have a walkabout over there, it's a very lovely area. Depending which direction you walk, it could be a little bit of swampy, and but other areas are nice.
May take you up at after the mosquito season. The fall would be lovely. Tell you. Thank you.
There you go. Thank you very much again for that presentation. Councillor Clare.
Just as a thing, I don't think we have a way to contact you to take you up on that offer. So perhaps you could send an email or something so that we would be able to communicate if you would.
I can leave a card with information. I think I have already submitted something on which I have my address and phone number and email.
Yes, we do have your contact information. Yes. So thank you very much, and thank you very much for the invitation. Very generous. So I'm going to move on and ask, would a member of council like to move to receive this this item presentation for information? Can I get a mover and seconder? Moved by Deputy Mayor Todd, seconded by Councillor Less. All in favor? Thank you very much.
I think we're done. Thank you very much. Thanks for
the patience. So now we're moving on to item 4, the consent agenda. Items listed under the consent agenda are considered collectively as one motion. Council members may request that specific items be removed for separate discussion, deliberation, and action. Would anyone like to remove any of the items listed under item 4 for further consideration? Okay, I'm the only one. I'd like to pull very briefly 4.1 and 4.5. So 4.1 with the Accessibility Advisory Committee. I was just wondering, Councillor Mink, if you might be able to just give us a little bit more of an update on the Vulnerable Persons Registry discussion that you've been having at that committee, because I think it's such an important item for this community.
Sure. So through the chair, so far, this has been a topic of discussion since this term for that committee. The discussion that's taken place so far is determining what type of registries we have, which is on this particular minutes. It isn't lost. The committee is still very much committed to finding a way to identify people who may have accessibility challenges in the event of an emergency or even a common disruption that we may experience. So that's a work in progress. That's all I have at this time.
I really like the idea of having a potential student project attached to that at some point. So maybe that's something that you can make sure comes forward at our next budget deliberations. The other item that I wanted to pull was 4.5 under the Environmental Advisory Committee. the RFP in terms of the terms of reference for the Climate Action Plan consultant. I'm just wondering if there could be any further information shared about that.
Yeah, I can start. and I can report that the committee has received a draft from staff and had an opportunity last week to review and provide comment on that draft. I also had an opportunity to sit down with Director Davidson and with Lauren Wingham-Smith, the manager of environmental remediation, who worked on the report. And I believe that's going to be moving forward very shortly. Perhaps Director Davidson could give us a timeline when that's expected.
It's anticipated to be on the website next week and it'll be posted for 3 weeks.
Fantastic. That's wonderful news. Okay, then I'm just going to move to ask for a mover and seconder to receive the consent agenda for information. Mover, I'll take Councillor Adam, and a seconder, I will take Councillor Mink. And all in favor? Thank you. Okay. As we move, you know, it's just whoever I looked at first, absolutely. As we move into our regular standing committees, I will turn it over to the chairs of the standing committees to chair their portion of the meeting. And we will start with corporate services. So I turn it over to Councillor Mink.
Thank you. Corporate services is open. 5.1 staff reports, none. 5.2 new business. 5.2.1 notice of motion regarding Port Hope hosting meeting to renew regional drug strategy. Moved by Councillor Hankinski, seconded by Mayor Hankinski, seconded by Councillor Pearson. Whereas the Council of the County of Northumberland received a delegation from Dr. Natalie Bocking, Medical Officer of Health and CEO of the Halliburton Kawartha Pine Ridge District Health Unit regarding the public health and opioid overdose crisis on April 12, 2023. And whereas the opioid crisis is a provincial and nationwide health epidemic that requires coordinated action on harm reduction, treatment, prevention, and enforcement. And whereas under its roadmap to wellness, the province is establishing a continuum of care through expanded mental health and addiction supports. And whereas local responses to the opioid crisis must be incorporated into this continuum of care to ensure safe, connected services that lead to improved health incomes. Now, therefore, it be resolved that the Municipality of Port Hope work with the Halliburton, Kawartha, Northumberland Drug Strategy to organize the first of what is anticipated to be a number of meetings across Northumberland County and beyond with key stakeholders, community representatives, and those with lived and living experiences to support the renewal of a drug strategy for our region that can address immediate responses and long-term solution. And be it further resolved that a copy of this motion be circulated to all Halliburton, Kawartha, Pine Ridge District municipalities. So we've had a mover and a seconder, and I will turn it over to the mayor to begin the discussions.
Well, I think that it's a pretty straightforward motion. It builds on something that was passed at the county table by all of the mayors. And the motion that was passed at county was really in response to the advice of Dr. Bocking that we really needed to start with an assessment strategy for the community and a renewal of a drug prevention plan for Northumberland County. So there was agreement around the table that these were the next steps that needed to be taken. And the only thing that I had done at that meeting was to say that I would bring forward to this council the suggestion that we kickstart the process by having a meeting here in Port Hope. And as the motion reads, the intention is to have a number of different meetings right across Northumberland County so that we start to actually put in some preventative actions to deal with the opioid crisis. And we're hoping that we can have that meeting in fairly short order by the end of June. The health unit will be leading the meeting. It will be putting forward the agenda. It will be identifying the key stakeholders that should be involved in that discussion. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that folks have about it.
Thank you. And I will turn it over to Council Claire.
I don't think I have a question, just a statement of support. I think we were in a lunch and learn just yesterday with the preeminent expert on municipal finances, in which she mentioned the list of key challenges facing municipalities across this province. And the opioid crisis was one of those key challenges that she specifically pointed to. So I think I applaud the mayor on her leadership in bringing this forward. And I would be really pleased to see Port Hope play a leading role and kickstart this process for our county and our community.
Thank you, Councillor Clare. Just one other point that some of you may not know is that Northumberland County is now number 10 in the province for suspected opioid overdoses. So it's a very sobering fact that we need to confront as a community.
Thank you. And is there any other questions or comments from the rest of council? So I just have one question. You had mentioned that these discussions may be taking place in other communities. Have you had a positive response so far from some of those other communities?
I think that what had started was that I volunteered to bring this forward to this council, and the other mayors then decided that they better follow suit. So I think it was just starting the momentum to knowing that these conversations need to start happening across the county.
Okay, thank you. So with no other questions or comments, I will call the vote. All in favor? And that is passed unanimously. So moving on, 5.2.2, notice of motion regarding ride-sharing vehicle for hire. This motion will be included on the agenda. It is included on the agenda to provide notice to the public. In accordance with the procedural bylaw, it will be automatically put over to the next meeting. This motion will be considered at the June 20th meeting of Committee of the Whole. And I will move on to my library report. So I'm going to change the order. I'm usually provided with a did you know fact at the end, and I think I'm going to move it up. So did you know the Port Hope Public Library cards are free to all residents of Port Hope, plus those who work and attend school in the municipality? Don't have a card, just drop by either the Mary J. Benson or Hub branch. It only takes a few minutes. Your local library also enjoys free reciprocal borrowing with Coburg Public Library. And as far as I understand, they have an agreement with Hamilton Township. So we can use both of those township libraries. And I think the attending school is a great benefit, especially with loyalists coming and having that opportunity to use our library. So at your library, the Special Collections Port Hope's well-documented history comes to life in the library's local history collection. The story of Port Hope, Hope Township, and the surrounding area is one vividly told through books, newspapers dating back to 1832, family histories, and census records. The library collection is housed in the Chemical Local History Room at the Mary J. Benson branch. Tired of squinting at the print and paperbacks? Give your eyes a break and try a title from the library's large print collection. You'll find the latest bestsellers, fiction and nonfiction, fiction, genre fiction, including mysteries, romance, western, science fiction, and fantasy. Current and back issues of the large print edition of Reader's Digest magazine. Audiobooks come in abridged and unabridged formats on CD, or as Playaway digital audiobooks. Check out the e-resources and apps on the website for access to downloadable audiobooks, ideal for visually impaired readers, commuters, people learning English, long trips, and people who like to read while working on a craft or hobby. Operations, summer Saturday hours of 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the Mary J. Benson branch are now in effect until Saturday, September 2nd. No change to the Saturday hours of 10 to 1 at the Hub branch. And Deputy Mayor Attridge, I'm trying to get you the answer about Sunday. That fell off my radar. I apologize. And programming throughout the month of June, Port Hope Public Library will provide a free drop-in family story time every Friday at 10:30 a.m. under the tree in Memorial Park. The next chapter, which I think it's a book club. We'll meet on Thursday, June 8th at 10:30 at the Mary J. Benson Branch. This month's feature is a seminar on the optimum diet for aging. And last, a Pride Zion workshop will be held on Saturday, June 10th from 10 to noon for youth at Mary J. Benson Branch. Recommended ages are 12 to 15. There are other Pride events scheduled if you go to the Public Library website. That is it for the library, and that's all for me for corporate services. Is there anything else from council? No. Nope. So corporate services is closed, and I will pass it over to finance.
Thank you. Finance is open. Staff report 6.1.1. Staff report FS1323 regarding the 2024 community grant and donation process. That a bylaw be presented to council to amend bylaw 68-2003, Schedule B, with a revised community grant policy and application form, and to repeal bylaw 40/2020. And I think Cassidy would like to make a few comments.
Thank you. Staff heard suggestions from Finance Committee to make improvements to the 2024 community grant process. So this report outlines the changes, including community grant funding will be allocated by a qualified external peer review. The evaluation process will include alignment to the strategic plan, and the grant program will focus on startup and growth funding for a maximum of 3 consecutive years to encourage financial sustainability and have available funding for new organizations. I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you. Okay, can we get a mover and a seconder to bring this onto the table? Moved by Councillor Mink, seconded by Councillor Pearson. Discussion. Councillor Chris.
Thank you very much, Chair. Whether it's to Mr. Baxter or yourself, there has been some active social discussion as well as pinpoint questions to Council. Will this new bylaw refine what the qualifications are, i.e. specifically charitable and or nonprofit? So will it say you have to be one of those two as a registered business to receive a grant going forward?
So you don't have to be a registered business. You've never had to be a registered business, and some of our applicants, I believe, are not registered businesses. You do need to be nonprofit, whether you are a charitable organization or not. So our actual, I guess on that front, that part has not changed. We will go and do a check on the registry just in case someone has registered and is registered in a way that is not compliant with the program as a check. But that aspect of the policy is not changing. It has always required you to be a nonprofit organization.
So thank you. Follow-up question to that then. So how do we ascertain a group matching that criteria?
Well, a nonprofit, its basic definition should identify when they submit their financials, they're not creating a profit. The alternative is to switch over and require any of our applicants to be a registered charitable organization, which would in turn create challenges if we are trying to encourage smaller grassroots startup organizations within our community. So the intention is not to, you know, create more bureaucracy around the program.
Thank you, Claire.
I have a follow-up to Chris's question, but I also have another, something else I'd like to say. So I think the confusion, and I can continue to be confused, because nonprofit community group is not a legal term. So if it's, which to me suggests that they're not required to be legally registered as not-for-profits. But I think that there seems to be a general understanding that you do need to be a registered not-for-profit, but that's not the terminology that we're using. And so, like, there's a discrepancy between our term of nonprofit community group and a registered not-for-profit corporation in Ontario, or federally registered not-for-profit corporation. So maybe that is a point of confusion.
So the intention, right, is to be supportive of a wide variety smaller potentially community organizations that are doing their work to the benefit of the community for nonprofit reasons. If the want of finance committee is for us to tighten that requirement up for you to be registered, for you to be a registered charity, for you to be a registered business and a nonprofit, like, we can do that. But I look to finance committee's direction. If this discussion is around, our experience over the past few months of one organization, and once it's been identified that they had something else out there, even though not a requirement, right? We did not provide them the funds until that was corrected. It was never corrected. We never provided them the funds, right? But open if there's direction from finance committee to put additional stipulations in place.
Just for the record, I wouldn't support that. I like that it's open to non-registered groups, because I think that is I think registration, even as a not-for-profit as opposed to a charity, sets a fairly high bar amongst community groups and volunteer-run projects. What I did also want to share, though, is overall, I'm not ready to move forward with the recommendations in the staff report, and I would instead be look to ask my colleagues to join me in a motion to defer this deliberation to a later date. I think the changes that were made to the process for the community grants this year were made from the table during our budget deliberations, and I feel the motivation and rationale was noble and very well intentioned, but I'm not sure that we achieved the result we were hoping for in terms of openness and transparency, and I feel a more fulsome post-mortem is needed. So for me, before we proceed down any way forward in terms of updating a policy or bylaw around the community grant program, I would love to see us just revisit the intended purpose of the program. So I think what is proposed here is very well thought out. Where's Staff Cassidy? Very, very well thought out and very well outlined if we are a granting body. But I'm not sure that's what we are or how we see ourselves. And is it possible that the community grant program is actually intended to be a responsive tool for closing gaps in services or tackling emerging needs in our community or supporting the continuation of activities that we deem are important but may not be eligible or able to be funded through other means? So if it is the latter, there may be other models worth exploring. I know I've had numerous conversations in the last number of months with applicants and grant recipients, but also other stakeholders in the community about alternative approaches. And I would appreciate being able to bring those forward for consideration alongside the model outlined in the staff report. And I think a more fulsome discussion at a later meeting would provide us with the opportunity to both agree on the purpose of the community grants program and to evaluate the best model for achieving that purpose.
I think I have Chris and then I have the mayor.
Thank you. I'll defer for now.
I think this is a really good pause that Councillor Clare is suggesting. And I just add one other piece of information that I think needs to be part of the mix of the conversation. And that is that the Port Hope Police Services Board is thinking about moving forward with a community granting program. And I think that it may behoove us to think about what is the relationship between these two granting opportunities, synergies, differences, and make sure that we're using monies in the best way possible and that there's no overlap. So I think that it would be good to bring forward some more information about that as well.
One thing we should consider is that under the terms of this bylaw, the Santa Claus Parade, Community Care, Greenwood Coalition, and Songs would be eliminated, and that's, it may or may not be the way we want to go. I think something like the Santa Claus Parade, we may want to give the same status as the Capitol Theater, to alleviate that problem. Some of the intent within the body is good. I think council, and it's my own opinion that council should take back the grant application process in terms of deciding who it's going to. That was what we were elected for. Councilor Mink?
Thank you. Thanks for the comments so far, and I don't really disagree with any comment that has been made. I think some of these, to the comment that Councillor Andrews just made too, some of these programs, every year when I look at these grants, I see very different categories. There's ones that are almost required, and then there's ones that are very much elective. So using the community care, I question how the other municipalities use it, since what we fund is the Western Route, which crosses over into Hamilton Township. So if we stopped funding that, how does that impact the overall operations? How does Hamilton Township handle that? So these are questions I still have. And if we give a three-year time limit and cut them off, then what? But my question to what Councillor Clare is proposing, and considering that staff will start working on budget very soon, when would that discussion take place? When would we give that feedback of what we want, and how would it impact the timelines for council working on budget?
Yeah, the period from September through December to react to it as a council. We don't get, usually the budget isn't presented to us until December, so we have ample time. And I know that the summer is not the best time to work. So does somebody have something? Did I miss something?
Thank you. Mr. Chair, I was just going to speak generally. It sounds like there's a motion to defer, and assuming there's a seconder, which we require, that's perfectly in order, takes precedent. The requirements to defer includes a naming the time and date, and a general sense of date is perfectly acceptable. So we do require a seconder if that's the case.
Can I get a seconder?
Some clarity on when we will be deferring.
All in favor? Deferred.
Well, I think that's a good question. And sorry, Brian, about the, I am making, in terms of the date, I'd be looking for some advice or input from Director. Staff a bit, I guess, on timelines.
So if I may, I was just going to dial back a little bit, Mr. Chair. I was trying to grab your attention. Just a point of clarification, the report notes that if we were to immediately implement a three-year limitation, there would be four groups that would not be eligible in the current year, right? That is part of the reason we would be deeming the current year as year one, and that would give us, you know, two additional years. And then we would be looking for to give consideration around foundational funding agreements, which could provide ongoing funding for something like the Santa Claus Parade. So I'm not sure if that's how you intended it, but I just want to make sure that the group is clear on that intention, that approving this would not mean that all of a sudden there would be four groups who would not be eligible for funding this year. So with that being said, then moving forward to the question around timing, we're bringing this forward now. In the question around budget, we had our management team budget kickoff meeting this morning. We have another meeting in 2 weeks. The plan is to be discussing budget at the beginning of July. We're bringing this forward now in case if there was anything that needed to come back, that provides us essentially another meeting in June. But we will, in August, we're getting, you know, everything ready and usually releasing the documents in August for them to come back 2 months later, right? So a Q4 means we would leave the process exactly as is right now, and we would be considering what we would do for the 2025 budget if we want to have a community grants program. We're bringing it forward now based on the feedback we received when we brought forward the results from the external third-party review, right? To be clear, from a staff perspective, the only update that we would specifically say we need to do is to update to accommodate the external third-party review, because we have direction from Finance Committee and Council to do that, but it's not in the policy. So from an administrative standpoint, that's the main update, and a few small administrative things just to align. Outside of that, we are just trying to be responsive to the feedback we received when we brought forward what the results were for the 2023 program, right, in updating the 2024 program. So we look to Finance Committee for direction. However, if we're implementing, if we're going to start and put the applications out in September, or really we try and get them out in August, we're, you know, I look to the direction in terms of the mover about, you know, what direction, you know, was to be provided to staff, either, you know, ideally at the next meeting in June.
So then if there were, I guess the question is, if there were alternative models that anyone wanted to propose, and I know that there are some stakeholders out there who have some thoughts about that, what would be the appropriate way to get those approaches onto the table for consideration by council alongside this option that's in the staff report?
So not knowing how well that would impact this program, right? I don't know whether that would mean moving forward with the community grant program and then looking to develop potentially another program, or whether that would mean looking at potentially seeing how that would roll into this. So staff at this point, we've been trying to be responsive to the feedback we've received thus far. If finance committee has alternate direction, then you know, you would need to provide clearly what that, you know, direction is, or what specifically you want investigated. I'll be mindful that, you know, our administrative assistant over there is our lead, and this is one of their responsibilities, and they're covering for other people right now. In terms of what that directing back to staff looks like, but if there's direction from finance committee, we'd look for that to come essentially in 2 weeks, and then we would do our best to update and then bring that forward again to the following meeting at the beginning of July.
Councilor Mink.
Thank you for that information. I think I read in the report that the foundational funding, you'll be reviewing that as well. Is that, again, at some point? Is that correct?
Well, that's correct. We're doing an initial trial. I believe there for 2 years can be extended, right? You remember earlier this year, Finance Committee just approved us to start the program. So we're a few months in, and hence why it's, you know, under consideration.
So just a follow-up comment. So I think with knowing that and that is continuously developing, and this is a start to the new grant program and considering budget timelines, in my opinion, we should move forward as is for this year and take the lessons learned and continue to build on this. I think it's going to be something that will have to be reviewed annually, both programs, the grant program and the foundational funding. We want to make sure that we're just not moving people into foundational funding and then we continue and do the same thing that we did under a different name. So I think this is something we need to continue to look at, and we should be moving forward. I appreciate the comments from Councillor Clare, but I think we need to move forward with this at this time.
Okay, how we want to handle this? Do we want to put a deferral on?
Yeah, can I add the timeline then, so that my motion is to defer until our June 20th meeting?
You a question? Will that give you enough time to accomplish what you want to try and accomplish?
I can try.
Okay. So we put that deferral on first and then vote on that. And then.
So we have a motion to defer consideration until June 20th, moved by Councillor Clare and seconded by Councillor Todd. So that is in order. That's the only outstanding.
So the motion's on the table. All those in favor of deferring? That's I have no new business, and I'll turn it over to planning and development with Deputy Mayor.
Thanks very much. Tonight we have three items. The first one is 7.1.1 staff report PD 15-23 recultivate 2023. That resolution be presented to council to approve the temporary use of the property at 1165 Fifth Line to host the Cultivate Festival September 22nd, 23rd, 24th of 2023, provided the organizers meet the following conditions. Number one, reaching agreement on the appropriate parking requirements, traffic. Sorry, it scrolls off my page. There we go. Traffic control conditions. Good Lord, never mind. Trishma. Here we go. Taking it from the top. Thank you. Number one, reaching agreement on the appropriate parking requirements, traffic control conditions, accessibility requirements to the satisfaction of protective services. Number two, offering limited camping for no more than 100 sites in tents during the festival. Number three, providing a fire safety plan to the satisfaction of fire prevention officer. Number four, successfully obtaining any permits required through the building department and any relevant outside agencies that may be required. And I'll pass this over to Director Davis to speak to.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. This report previous council contemplated this opportunity for the 2022 season. Cultivate, as many of you know, is a community festival celebrating local food and music. It had been hosted for many years in Memorial Park in Port Hope. And in 2022, they announced their intention to move to the rural space at the HOCO property at 1166 Fifth Line in Port Hope. The challenge with moving that activity to the rural space was that the zoning bylaw does not permit that type of work. However, we did recognize that as we are working our way through the housekeeping zoning bylaw amendment, the intention was to create, as part of the on-farm diversified uses opportunities related to these types of activities. And so we used that last year as a pilot project. I would note that the festival was very successful. The municipality received zero negative feedback nor complaints from the public to permitting that activity in that space. They've approached the municipality. Our intention was to have the housekeeping bylaw in place that would permit this as of right on that property. That is not the case. We intend to bring that bylaw forward very soon. However, recognizing that there's appeal periods, et cetera, and a festival needs time to plan, prepare, and sell tickets, we're asking for council to advance this opportunity again for 2023. I would point out a couple of things that are not actually related to the use on the land. First and foremost, when I talked about in the discussion period, I define pulled a future definition that will be coming as part of the housekeeping bylaw amendment related to farm event short-term venue and its meaning. And I state in the last sentence, it may or may not be open to the public and or, which I'm missing the or, is operated by a profit, for profit or gain, but can only last for three consecutive calendar days each year. That is not to mean that, that is, the intention was that it could be a for-profit enterprise or a not-for-profit enterprise that is operating. And so I'm sorry that there was some confusion there. I just want to be straight that the Cultivate Festival is a not-for-profit activity. It is also a recipient of the community grant program, which you were just discussing. And so I wanted to recognize my omission there. They can be supported as a not-for-profit. I would also point out in the financial considerations, we did recognize, and if you went through the municipal overview that was provided to us by Cultivate, they made a series of in-kind requests as part of this. I'm not asking council to make a decision on that. I would note two things. First of all, Cultivate is the recipient already of a community grant. And secondarily, it isn't my department's decision as to whether those in-kind requests could be honored. In fact, it I think maybe falls to my neighbor here who will go through that process at the appropriate time. So we're not asking for any further in-kind or financial opportunities. We're just asking for the right or allowing that organization to have the right host that event in September. Happy to take any questions you may have.
Wonderful. Thanks very much, Council. Any questions? Great. Seeing none, all in favor, or first, second, and all in favor? Mover. Thank you. Moved by Councillor Ming, seconded by Councillor Adam. All in favor? Wonderful. Thanks very much. Moving on to 7.1.2. This is a... Thank you. Sorry, my screen's freezing. All right. The staff report is a resolution be presented to council to adopt the policy on windows renovation in heritage buildings as provided by Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee. And I'm going to ask Sagar to please speak to this.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. So the purpose of this report is to formally endorse the policy on windows renovation in heritage buildings prepared by Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee. This policy encourages the owners of the heritage designated properties to repair and retain the original historic windows on their designated properties. Because the original historic windows are an integral part of the historic buildings and contribute to the architectural rhythm of the buildings, therefore, the policy is also aligning with the conservation objectives of the standards and guidelines for the conservation of historic places in Canada, and also the conservation objectives set up by the Municipality of Port Hope Official Plan and the Heritage Conservation District Plans. Therefore, staff and HPH both recommend that the policy on windows renovation in heritage buildings be formally endorsed. I'm happy to take any questions from the council. Thank you.
Thanks, Kenny. I'll take a mover in a second here so we can get on the floor. Moved by Councillor Less, seconded by Councillor Chris. And opening for questions, Councillor Less.
Thanks, Sagar. Sagar and Director Davis and myself spent many minutes on this over the years with the committee. And my contention is I understand replication of the windows is extremely important, and 100% behind that. The Dreamers and the other building across the street are two examples of windows that were recently done. The vinyl windows that went in look fine. They're very economical. They certainly did the trick, and you couldn't tell the difference. Dreamers had a little bit more issues with their wooden replications, in that the window, whatever they call them, the things that frame the window panes, kept falling out. Whether they hold up the test of time is going to be interesting. They were, I can't give you the exact multiplication, but they were at least double the cost of the vinyl windows. So those are the two scenarios. And what I find very interesting is that Heritage Port Hope are not asking for wooden windows, because they say you can have wooden windows that are metal clad. Well, that makes about as much sense as putting in wooden windows that are vinyl clad to me. So, or not even putting wood in and just getting on with the job. So I'm confused, and I can't support this because I know the intent is to ram into wooden windows, and I think that is very cost prohibitive.
Thanks very much.
Just my thoughts.
Yeah, no worries. Just as a maybe a point of clarification as well, Sagar, under this, is a building owner forced to put in wood windows, or is there an option to put something else in?
Through the chair, no property owners are not forced. However, if the policy is endorsed, we will require the window, the building owners to demonstrate to us that the windows are not restorable. Only then we can go for replacement in kind, that is replacing with the wooden windows. So they are not forced. However, they need to demonstrate to the HPH and staff that the existing windows are not restorable.
Yeah, I understand that, and you know, that's the process that we went through. And when the vinyl windows were proposed, the presentation was made, and the council made an economic decision on behalf of the owner to go that way, and that's wonderful. And we didn't have to have that conversation with Dreamers, because he went on his own. It was what he thought was the right thing. So thank you, Sagar.
Question for me is that aligns with what you were saying, right? Or it does not align with what you're saying? You were saying that it, like, you were worried that, or you were,
as long as the building owner isn't forced to do it, that I know that, because some can't be restored, right. In a lot of cases the windows were made many years ago and not of the best woods.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Mink.
Thank you. So just to clarify, so I remember the discussion about the one on the corner there across from Dreamers. And so they're not forced to restore their existing windows, but they would be required to replace with other wooden windows. Is that correct?
If the windows are considered as heritage attributes in the designation bylaw of the building, then we do ask the applicants to go for replacement in kind, because that meets the conservation principles of heritage.
Okay, and I have a follow-up question. Has there been any discussion with the property owners? When you walk down Walton, there are a lot of buildings with very, very bad windows. And from my discussions, they're very, very costly. And rents are, they can rent the unit out regardless of whether they replace their window or not. From my own research, when the Walton windows came up before, I looked at Europe for an example of what do they do with very historic buildings. And the policy across Europe is preserve the building. The building is most important. So I really appreciate preserving our heritage district. But I do fear when I walk and look up and see the state of some of those windows, because they simply cannot afford to replace them, that it's actually getting into the building envelope, the deterioration. So that's just my concern about this entire issue with windows.
Thanks very much. Any other questions from council? Okay, seeing none, then all in favor? I thought we did the mover and second already. Yeah. Yep. So here, I'll read it again. So what we have is that a resolution be presented to council to adopt the policy on windows renovation in heritage buildings as provided by the Heritage Port Hope Advisory Committee. Moved, seconded. Yeah. And then we discussed, and then now we'll vote. Did I miss anything? No, I got it. Okay. All in favor? All right. Thanks very much.
We'll need to call for all opposed.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. All opposed. Great. Do I say not carried?
Defeated.
Defeated. Perfect. There you go. I don't know if you've ever got that yet. There you go. Yeah, I think so. I don't know. Certainly, I've never had to pull that forward. Okay, moving right along. We'll now move into our third report, 7.1.3, which is report number PD 17-23, Provincial Policy Statement 2023. The recommendation that a resolution be presented to council authorizing the mayor to submit a letter to the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing expressing concerns related to the draft provincial policy statement 2023 as it relates to the removal of municipal autonomy in planning decisions and potential negative impacts to agricultural and rural land use policies. And I will pass that to Director Davis.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. So to Council, this report comes forward. Most lower tier and the upper tier Council in Northumberland have dealt with this matter. In early April, the province released both Bill 97 in draft form with the first reading and the new provincial policy statement titled Provincial Policy Statement 2023. That is the primary policy document that we use when assessing land use practices across the province of Ontario. When the province passes that statement or puts that statement forward, it is our responsibility to respond and in kind with those policies. You will note, or I would note, that future work on the on an official plan review would be one of its responsibilities is to take into consideration the provincial policy statement so that it's reflected in our own land use policies as we use them in Port Hope. I would also suggest that regardless of whether we adopt policies of the provincial policy statement in our own official plan, they supersede any plans that we have and that we are responsible to administer these policies as they come forward. I bring forward today sort of a general overview. It's a very comprehensive 83-page. The provincial policy statement itself is an 83-page document. It's comprehensive. It makes substantial changes to or proposes numerous changes to the way we do land use across the province, including but not limited to how we monitor or plan for growth, transit, intensification, how we deal with our settlement areas, how we go about municipal comprehensive reviews or our official plan review process, how we deal with employment lands, rural lands, agricultural lands, and how we incorporate things like natural heritage and climate change into future decision processes. I would say that staff generally support, for the most part, most of the provincial policy statement and Bill 97 as proposed. What I would suggest, or where we do draw some substantial concern, is around areas where municipal autonomy is eroded through this document, so that because a number of those policies will constrain our ability to determine local solutions and offer local context in our own policy documents. As well, there are substantive changes proposed to agricultural policy in particular, related to the ability to take three housing lots off a piece of prime agricultural land. And why I suggest this is a substantive change, the tradition of land use policy in this province for a number of years, more than 50, has been to protect prime agricultural property. And what we're saying, suggesting now, and really what we've done over the years, if you think about the way that we set up our official policy documents, we have prime agricultural lands, which are untouchable, meaning that they can't be severed, or they shouldn't be severed, and we are only allowed to take an old farmhouse off that land if it's out of use. Otherwise, we have to maintain those blocks for agricultural or farming purposes. And we direct our development into what we call settlement areas in the urban area. That would be the urban area or the urban ward. Also, our hamlet areas in the rural area. That helps us focus how we deal with services. It also focuses on how we deal with land division and all these different things. And so changing that will fundamentally change how we view or how we deal with land use in our rural area. It also is, I would recognize that the Ontario Federation of Agriculture and a number of local, regional, and provincial agricultural organizations are very concerned with this proposal or this portion of the proposal, and which is why we're asking Council to consider the opportunity to make comments back. Happy to take any comments you may have or questions related to this.
Great. Thanks very much. Can I get a mover and a seconder to bring for discussion? Moved by Councillor Chris, seconded by Councillor Adam. Any questions from Council? Councillor Chris?
Yeah, thank you very much, Director, through the Chair. Have we consulted with the Rural Committee? I say that with a question and then I'll follow up with a statement. I've been contacted. I don't know if my partner has in the North as well. The rural community is actually looking forward to this bill because of the empowerment it will allow, because of their families, and they view our planning bylaws very restrictive, and not even restrictive, challenging. There's a number of files, and I won't belabor that today. I'll save it for the next council meeting. But they see this as the empowerment to allow that transition to their families and through the allotment of the additional housing issues that they see that, because they are then in control versus the town. Can you comment on that, please?
Certainly. So through the Chair, back to Councillor Collins, I would actually point out that it's not the town that is in control of prime agricultural land blocks. It's a provincial policy and has been such for a number of years. So the reality is the town has been handcuffed in an effort to allow for land severances on prime agricultural land because the province has disallowed it for a substantial period of time. And the reason that the province does that is their attempt or an effort to preserve our agricultural stock so that we have lands to grow food on. Recognize that rural property holders desire the ability to sever their lands and take housing stock out of those lands. It's just a deviation from the way that this process has been done for many, many years. And so, I mean, our preference or our support is of, while I recognize that the rural residents have done that, are the Ontario Federation of Agriculture and those that are in the agricultural industry have spoken very loudly that they're opposed to this activity.
Yeah, thank you for that. But I will respectfully challenge, when we start zoning, we are in control of that. And when we start zoning property that is wooded and then we label it as prime agricultural, that's a challenge for the residents there. So with the greatest respect, I do rebut that one. It is within our empowerment of the zoning that we do that. We set up, we're rezoning, and we have some substantial property coming up through our zoning reviews where it's going to be changing. We had a speaker here a few months ago that attesting to the fact that she wanted to put a home there, but it's going to be rezoned.
Through the chair to Councillor Collins, I guess my response to that would be it's not we don't have the power under rezoning to allow, I mean, any application that came on a land that was designated prime agricultural, the staff is bound by provincial policy to oppose that. You may, so if somebody came forward and asked us to sever a piece of prime agricultural land, they can make the application. I could bring it forward, it would come forward to council for a deliberation. Staff's position would have to be aligned with the provincial policy on prime agricultural land. What you may be referring to is because in the rural area, we have two different kinds of lands designated. We have prime agricultural land designated, but we also have rural lands designated. That would be my only response. I can't comment on the specific activity. I would just suggest that through land designation is what controls our ability to support severances.
Thanks, Chris. Any other? Yeah, Councillor Mink.
Thank you. So through the chair, I echo Councillor Collins, the feedback that I continuously get and the reality what is happening in the rural areas. I appreciate saving agricultural land. However, what is happening, the trend that is happening here and across Ontario is that while people are struggling to stay on their family farms and cannot be afforded a half acre to share that land with family, they're leaving. And what's happening is there are other farming practices moving in, and we see it here, who are bringing very harmful farming practices to our community. So rather than sparing a quarter of an acre for a severance, we are losing potentially hundreds of acres to poor farming practices, which are leading to damaging soil integrity, erosion, destruction of our infrastructure, and so on. So I'm really, I think this is a little more, there's a little more to this than just saving acreage. So I have a hard time supporting this. I hear continuously from the community that they want to stay, but they can't because they can't afford to live there anymore. And all they want is half an acre. I think we're losing a farm a year, it seems like. And I can drive us around and show us the farms that are gone now that used to be century farms, and they're gone. The houses are sitting empty. It's concerning. And it's here, and it's real.
Councillor Clare, I see you. I'm going to come back. Todd, how do we, or is there a way that we reconcile the concerns that are happening in our rural community about severancing against Bill 97? I recognize I'm putting you on the spot there, but mm-hmm. Is there a reconciliation between those two items?
Certainly. So, I mean, the reality is the policy statement is the policy statement. Right. So this is a draft policy statement. Staff are recommending, based on the way that the province has traditionally dealt with agricultural lands, that this is a significant departure. If council doesn't support a letter to the, or comment, they don't have to make the comment. So they can defeat my proposed resolution, and I'm fine with that. I made a recommendation that we would do that because that's the reality of land use planning in this province for 50 years. Or strategy to deal with land in this province for 50 years. I recognize that the local context is the local context. I also recognize that residents who own rural properties that are prime agricultural will always want to take the severances that they're entitled to if there's an opportunity to do that. And if this elected body chooses to support that activity, by all means. It doesn't mean that's going to happen tomorrow. It doesn't mean that the province isn't going to change the provincial, or it doesn't mean that the provincial policy statement is going to stand the way that it stands today, based on the amount of feedback that they've received from other jurisdictions. So simply put it out there for contemplation for council, in support of what land use planning professionals are doing across the entire county and across the province of Ontario. But the reality is if council decides that they are supportive of this type of activity in our rural space, by all means, they don't need to support the resolution. We don't need to make comment on this.
Wonderful. Thanks very much. And then, Councillor Ming.
Sorry, so through the chair, one question. If this is passed by the province, can we then stipulate how big those severances are?
Through the chair, to Councillor Mink, it depends how prescriptive the policy is. So if the policy is prescriptive, then we are bound by what the provincial policy statement says. We have to support, our goal is, or responsibility as professional planners is to support the statement, the policy as passed by the province.
All right. And thanks for your patience, Councillor Clare. Okay, there we go.
Thank you. I did have a comment, but I just in response to the concern raised here by Councillor Mink, I think, you know, protecting our ability as a municipality to make these decisions in a way that makes sense for our municipality is the crucial point here. And I think that's really well articulated in your report and in the letter. And I think, you know, when it comes to this issue as relates to rural Port Hope, there are other ways for us to address that as a municipality in terms of potentially looking at additional residential units through a different lens in terms of what's appropriate in the rural area. For example, some of the constraints in our policy around additional residential units may be actually the barrier that folks are experiencing who just want to be able to have family also have a house on that same property. So I don't know that this is necessarily the way to address the concerns that rural residents have. And there are also, I'm aware, I feel cheeky because I'm not a rural resident myself, but I also am involved in environmental work in our community and across the county. And there are rural residents from Port Hope and beyond that are actively organizing locally here, including planning an event at the end of July about this issue specifically, arguing that we need to be protecting our agricultural land and opposing these kinds of policies that are likely to result not in across the board, not just in individual families being able to have, you know, their son or daughter have a house and stay on that land. But the reality is agricultural land is going to be sold off and we're going to see subdivision applications, which we know rural residents also oppose when they're coming forward. So I think it's maybe a bit more nuanced in terms of this particular policy statement. But I support the letter. I think that we should be opposing the pieces of that policy statement as outlined by staff. And for me, as I said, we are seeing an erosion of our authority as communities, that basically our ability to be the masters of our own destiny is being threatened on many fronts right now. And this is another one of those. And I think that we absolutely need to be standing up and saying that we should retain that authority, that we know best what's best for our community, and that we need to have the ability to plan our future in the way that makes sense for us. And so anytime another level of government starts to undermine that and try to take that authority back from us, I think we owe it to all our residents to say no.
Thanks very much, Mayor.
Thank you very much for the report. I actually really enjoyed reading it and seeing what the impact and implications are. And I really think that we have to sort out the issue in our rural community around severances. I really do, because as much as Councillor Clare is saying that, we're threatened by subdivisions popping up, we're also, as Councillor Mink has pointed out, losing really important farmland because families can't continue to live together, and we lose the opportunity to have multi-generational living. So I'm hearing what both Councillor Collins and Councillor Mink say, and it's a real concern for me, absolutely. But as is the concern around all the different legislation that is impeding on our ability to make decisions as a municipality. And so how do you balance that and weigh all of that? And, you know, I am very concerned. But I have a practical question for you, and that is, we've gone through the third reading on this, and it's on the way to royal assent. So what power do we have in terms of a statement on this at this point?
Thanks for your very practical question, and that is as is the practice now at the province, they leave comment period open long after they go through the debate process. And so the comment period remains open, which is why we are bringing it to you today, recognizing that the reality is if they're at third reading and they're going to get royal assent on these items in very near future, it is going to be what it's going to be. And I don't know how to, you know, I wish I could say differently, that it would look differently or that it would work differently. But I mean, we also noticed this with Bill 23, where they passed Bill 23, yet kept comment periods open for 60 and 90 days after the legislation had received royal assent.
Yeah, I just think it was important to make that point publicly.
No, thank you.
Do we have any other questions on this item before we go to vote? Just a reminder, what we're voting on is that a resolution be presented to council authorizing the mayor to submit a letter to the Ministry of Municipal Affairs and Housing expressing concerns related to the draft provincial policy statement 2023 as it relates to the removal of municipal autonomy in planning decisions and potential negative impacts to agricultural and rural land use. All in favor? And pass. And that concludes our staff reports for tonight. For new business, I have no new business. Does anyone have anything they'd like to bring forward for planning and development? Nope, thanks very much. Then we're going to be closing planning and development, and I will pass this over to Councillor Adams for Parks, Recs, and Culture.
Well, thank you, Deputy Mayor. So Parks, Recreation, and Culture is now open. We do have a couple of staff reports today. So we're going to start off with 8.1.1. Fortunately, this thing doesn't show us the name of it properly. So June 6, 23, PRC 0726 event and activity report. And if I could get our director to speak to that, please.
Thank you, Councillor. This report outlines upcoming events and activities that are planned in the community over the next couple of months. We brought this process forward when we reviewed the special event review process a number of years ago to be sure that council and community is aware of number of applications that come through that process. And we've also taken the opportunity to highlight some of the examples of programming, but also the third-party providers for events in our community. This is not a comprehensive list. Our events and activity schedule changes on a daily basis, so staff always encourage council and members of the community to actively be looking at the calendar listings on the My Porthole page, but this is shared for your information and happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you so much. Any questions from council? Councillor Les?
Just a comment. It was brought to my attention that seniors over the age of 80 get free access to Jack Burger Pool. Do we publicize that?
Yes, we do. We put that provision into place when we did a comprehensive fee review, I believe, in 2020. So that was, the start of the pandemic. So I can certainly take that back with our team to see if there's some more advertising opportunities. Anybody who is that age within our recreation software or system is given that notification for that opportunity.
Yeah, I think it's just a positive that we could promote.
Thank you, Councillor. Any other questions? No, so a motion that receive PRC 0723 be received for information. Can I get a mover and a seconder? Moved by Mayor Lena, seconded by Councillor Mink. All in favor? And pass. Thank you. Moving on to 8.1.2, staff report. PRC 0823, Lion Center lease agreement. And again, I'll pass that off to our director.
Thank you, through the chair. The existing lease with the Lions Club of Port Hope is a long-standing agreement for terms of use related to the municipally owned facility known as the Lions Recreation Center. The current lease was a five-year lease, and it does come to term in 2023. As all of the use and terms identified in the previous lease have been completed to the satisfaction of the municipality, staff are recommending proceeding with another five-year term for the lease for that site.
Thank you. Any questions from council on this? Council Huss?
Just a small niggly point that someday we may want to take that back, that property back. And I don't know if we would in the next 5 years, but I'm wondering if we should go for a 3 year just in case. But that's just a negotiating point. Just for your consideration.
Thank you for that feedback. Any other questions on that, Councillor or Deputy Mayor?
I have a follow-up question. Is there there's a termination clause in there of 90 days, is that right?
Yes, through the chair, there is a termination clause in the lease. From a long-term plan standpoint, related to our leisure services master plan, from a recreation standpoint, no, there's nothing identified kind of in that five-year term that we would be identifying that site. We also, work closely with Alliance, who have an existing agreement with the Legion as well. So there's those considerations, but that's, feedback that I can take direction from committee.
Thank you. And does that answer your question? Okay. Does that answer it for you guys? You good? Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so motion that bylaw be presented to council to authorize five-year lease agreement with the Lions Club of Port Hope on 20 Thomas Street, known as the Lions Club Recreation Center. Can I get a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by Councillor Collins and seconded by Councillor Clare. All in favor? And passed. Thank you. What are you guys waiting for? Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, the PRC new business is now open. Parks and Recreation and Seniors Month is underway. Lots of free programming options happening for all ages. Visit porthope.ca/recreation. It was great to see so many smiling faces at the Town Park Expansion Project Senior Center open house last week. Yeah. The facility looks amazing. Hopefully everybody's had a chance to come out and take a look at it and donate. I had the opportunity to speak with many community members that attended, and everyone had great things to say. Thank you to Leslie and the staff and all the volunteers that made that day so wonderful. The 55-plus program committee is working with staff to interpret the older adult need assessment results and to use it to guide the fall program planning. Now, the fundraising committee is working on securing meetings with some local businesses and industry around the town, obviously to fund. They're also looking or planning food sales and glow sticks for Canada Day. As you're probably aware, the summer events planning is well underway. The community can expect to see the return of the outdoor movie series. The Movies in the Park is an amazing opportunity to enjoy community social time while watching a family-friendly movie outdoors in Memorial Park. Port Hope Canada Day celebrations on July 1st are set to be an incredible day of fun in the sun. Well, let's hope it's in the sun. looking forward to seeing everyone for the parade and all the fun festivities. If you've been to the Town Park Recreation Center recently, and hopefully you were to see the expansion, you'll notice that the construction of the outdoor pickleball courts are well underway. The estimated time of completion is early July, coming up soon. I'm really looking forward to my first ever official pickleball game. I have challenged Councillor Chris Collins to a game, and and I am looking forward to not just playing my first ever pickleball game, but also getting my first ever pickleball victory. Now that is all I have for that is all I have for new business for the PRC right now. Does any other in council have any Councillor Mink?
Thank you. So what I wasn't planning on saying, I'll say first, is that I'll challenge the winner of the two of you. Not that I know how to play pickleball, but I'll probably win. I just want to thank the numerous departments on behalf of Heroes Higher Ride this weekend, who made this year a success. In my opinion, it went almost flawlessly. Probably one of the best runs so far. And I just want to say thank you to Parks and Rec. I'm not sure if they're the ones that closed the road or if it's Works that closed the roads, fire, and emergency services, Port Hope Police. This event it's a free event. They don't ask for any money, but they do ask for the support of the municipality. And they do appreciate how well organized it went. So thank you.
Thank you so much. And I'll add to that, I completely agree. This year was fantastic. We had a great turnout. And I've been part of it for every year that it's gone on. And this year, I think people stayed the longest. The entertainment in the park was amazing. We had the JJIU kids up there dancing, and that was a lot of fun. We had a musical performance, and it seemed as though everybody there had a great time. So thank you. I appreciate that. Anything else from council for new business? I see none, so we're closing the PRC, and I'll move this over to Councillor Clare.
Our dwindling audience will be pleased to know that this part will be very short. There are no staff reports on the agenda this evening. Is there any other new business under Works and Engineering? Other than to compliment Jeanette and I on our coordinated wardrobe choice for this evening, I will call Works and Engineering closed. And I will pass this on to Councillor Chris.
I will be just as quick. Thank you, Councillor Kerr. Protective Services, no staff reports, no new business, unless somebody wants to put up their hand. Having said that, Protective Services is closed. And over to the Mayor.
Well, thank you very much for everybody's patience. We are now at our question period. So remember, question period is for questions directed to council. So we ask that if anybody's got some questions, step forward, identify your name, address, and ensure that the purple button is turned on. So we will start, though, first with councillors. Are there any other questions for council tonight? No? From the media. I'm still hoping. And from residents, please.
Well, sometimes I feel like I need to when I'm talking to Brian. But there's a lot of important issues were discussed tonight, and I wish that the council chamber was full for the second half of the meeting. Less, the windows on the east side of Queen Street will be gone long before the ones on the west side. I guarantee you that will happen. The Dreamers windows will outlast vinyl windows 10 times over. And I can tell the difference between the vinyl windows and wood windows.
$50 and I'll see you in 100 years.
Okay. We'd love your question.
My question is on the Ganaraska Forest. We all know that Canada is burning. Halifax's problem is because of the storm. One of their problems is because of the storm and all the downed wood. I've had two residents, one on the west side of the Ganaraska Forest, one on the east side of the Ganaraska Forest, ask what's happened to all the fire routes. What is our fire plan for the Ganaraska Forest? It's 15,000 acres that is going to explode if we don't take charge.
Wonderful question. And it was, in fact, a question that I tackled directly in the Mayor's Corner this last Friday with a very extensive write-up that was supported by Director Williams, who is not here this evening. But it was also then further followed up with some additional information made on our municipal website. And I'm going to turn it over to Kate to fill you in. I can assure you that there is a very robust plan in place, and there was a very preemptive response to all of the fires that are happening across Canada in order to inform and better relay the information around what our plan is, in particular around the Ganaraska Forest.
Thank you, through the chair. So as the mayor mentioned, the information, I don't know if you're a subscriber to the Mayor's Corner, I encourage you to do so. But she did write quite a big lengthy write-up on burning safety and fire prevention. And we also provided some links through the help of the fire department on our fire prevention and public education page. So through that page, if you click down or scroll down the page a little bit, there is a bunch of information about preparing for wildfires. There's information from the federal government and the Ontario government. And there's also a current Ontario wildfire activity and restrictions link where Ontario monitors the wildfires and gives lots of information about the prevention. So it doesn't speak necessarily to the fire routes. Director Williams will have to speak to that at a later date, I assume, but there is a lot of information that we've posted on that page.
Okay, my concern is not about prevention. My concern is what happens when it starts.
And that was addressed in the Mayor's Corner. Director Williams did provide information about what the steps are if a fire does break out in Ganaraska Forest. And we would certainly, I think we could work with our communications team to add that information or add the content of the corner onto the municipal website.
Yeah, he took the information right from the website that was put into the Mayor's Corner. So the information is there.
So are those fire routes going to be cleaned up? Where's the money coming from? I gather the Ministry of Natural Resources, when they left managing those fire routes, nothing's been done to keep those fire routes open.
Yeah. Well, we can certainly take the question specifically about the fire routes back to Director Williams and make sure that a response to that is also on the website as a follow-up.
And is the Ganaraska Conservation Authority not responsible, or whose responsibility is the Ganaraska Conservation Authority refire?
As I understand it, and I wish Director Williams was here this evening because he would be able to provide a much more fulsome response than I am right now at almost 10 p.m. But as I recall, he explained it that if there was a fire that broke out in the forest, that the municipality would be working hand in hand with the province on extinguishing that fire. And that is part of a very well thought through plan that he's been working on. And perhaps Councillor Mink would like to add to that.
Thank you. And that is a very good question. Since the Derecho storm last year, there's parts of the forest that are very accessible to all sorts of vehicles for that cleanup effort. There's a lot of big logging trucks brought in for over a year. So there are particular areas. However, there's other areas that they haven't even got to for fallen trees yet because they just don't have the capacity. It's a very valid question that you have. They've been focusing on cleaning up the storm damage, which is 600 acres, I think, or something like that, that was completely downed, and some of those other routes, I can't confidently say that they were given the attention that they needed. But being a representative of that board, I will follow up for you.
The one other thing in terms of there's the ground routes, but Director Williams also talked about the fact that there would be a direct engagement with water bombers that would be sent out for those efforts.
Thank you. That's great.
Jim, before you go, do you have the location of the trails that are still, like the fire trails that are still clogged up?
I'm not as aware of the situation in the Ganaraska Forest as the two people that I have spoken to who use it on a regular basis. And they were just really concerned about this issue. And I said, I come to council every time, so I'll ask the question. So I'm going to go back and say, get on the mayor's corner, read about it, maybe call the Ganaraska.
Well, that's what I was going to say, because they actually have it on their mapping system so that you can point out the problem areas, or they can at least contact too, so we can take a look at it too. So if they do have a problem area that hasn't been addressed yet, if they do forward that over, we can make sure we get it looked at.
Great. Well, I'm concerned about the Ganaraska Forest, because if without the Ganaraska Forest, we might as well wash Port Hope into Lake Ontario, which was happening in the 20s and 30s. I mean, it is a hugely important piece of our environment that we have to protect. And I'm not sure that we all take it seriously enough.
I think I can assure you that this council takes it very seriously.
I understand the council takes it seriously, but where are all the people?
Yeah. Yeah, but thank you very much. And we'll sharpen the information around that. Very helpful to get that feedback. Okay. Okay, well, here we are. Adjournment. This concludes our business to be covered on today's agenda. We've reached the end of our agenda, and I'm in a position to adjourn at 9:56 p.m. Thank you very much to council and to staff for staying, and for the public who is still here.